So let's talk about the death of the death of planning. So recently I was asked to make a 5-year plan for a research proposal. And it really made no sense because technology is changing so quickly today that a 5-year plan is going to be out of date certainly within a year or two. So it made sense to plan maybe 20 years ago. But if you look at the rate at which knowledge is being developed, about 100 years ago, 1900, it took about 100 years for knowledge to double. But by the Second World War, that was down to 25 years. And today it's estimated that it's doubling every 2 years. And IBM predicts that soon it'll be developing twice every day. So planning in the traditional sense, in that kind of environment, is impossible. And Henry Mintzberg wrote a paper called The Fall and Rise of Strategic Planning back in 1994. It was in the Harvard Business Review. And he pointed out that planning itself produces all these jobs related to planning, but actually have very little relevance in the real world. That, as we've seen recently, we've had a pandemic that's changed everything in the business world. We had the price of oil become negative. And if you think about industries that are not changing that rapidly, I thought the oil industry was one of those. Now, if you look at the IT industry, it's changing very rapidly. That in the last 5 years, we've seen the development of DevOps and that of agile planning for work and projects. And so different areas certainly are moving at a different pace. The military have a term for this. They call this, it's a VUCA world, that everything is moving now with a high velocity. There's a great deal of uncertainty in the world. The complexity of business is increasing, and certainly there's a lot of ambiguity. So how do we operate in this kind of world? Well, one of the things is that we need to change our mindset, that many of us were brought up in this generation of Newtonian physics, where we believed that we could predict a lot of things. Certainly we could predict the motion of the planets, we could predict how things in physics behaved with great accuracy. But we, to some extent, were looking under the light, the lamplight, if you like, that we're searching for something we've lost, and we can't search in the dark, so we search under the place where there are light. And Stephen Wolfram produced a book pointing this out to scientists, that we were solving the problems that our methods allowed us to solve, but we weren't solving real world problems. And Brian Arthur in the late 1990s, pointed this out, that economics had assumptions of stability, of equilibrium states. Even in game theory, we talk about equilibrium states, the things tending to these states. But he showed that for most economic problems, that wasn't true. That even for some simple economic problems, they didn't tend to equilibrium states, but were forever in a state of flux. In a sense, that we're dealing with a world that's a complex adaptive system. It's a system that doesn't ever enter the same state twice. It's forever changing. He had a famous observation about a bar in Santa Fe. So he is part of the Santa Fe Institute, and there's a bar called El Farol. And if more than 60 people go to it, it's just too crowded. And so he posed the problem, everyone needs to decide fairly independently whether they go to the bar or not. Now, if you believe that the bar is going to be empty, then you actually will go there. Whereas if you believe it will be full, you won't go. And when he analyzed this problem, he showed that it never reached an equilibrium state, that people were always changing their mind. They're trying to predict what other people will do. And this is like the real markets. The financial market, we are actors in that market ourselves and we influence it. Now, we can't tell how other people are going to behave in that market. And so predictions are very difficult for these kinds of systems. So this is the mindset that I'm talking about, that we need to change our mindset that we can command these systems, that we can predict them. And this has huge impact from the way that we operate in business. And certainly in the IT area, we've moved from waterfall methods that basically say, yes, we know exactly what the problem is, and we know how to construct the solution, to agile methods which say, well, we'll deal with the customer, and the customer will know what their problem is, and we'll be flexible, we'll be agile, we'll respond to the customer's needs. But even agile is not necessarily the right way. It depends on what kind of system you're dealing with. And David Snowden pointed this out, that if you're dealing with a system that you've dealt with before and is highly predictable and that things are repeatable, then perhaps you can use the waterfall method. But if you're dealing with complex adaptive systems, systems that are changing rapidly and never enter the same state again, then your past experience may not be that relevant. And therefore, you need to adopt some other method. Now, Agile has been adopted by the IT industry, but IT actually borrowed it from John Boyd of the military, who invented the OODA loop, which essentially is you observe, you orient yourself, you decide, you act. This is a loop you go through, and it's very similar to Agile. Now, the lean movement that came out of the Toyota production system actually comes at another slightly different angle and emphasizes learning, that you need to do things in small steps, that you need to plan a direction, you need to know where you're going in general, but you shouldn't treat it like a moonshot, that you shouldn't be developing a 3-year or a 5-year plan and saying, we're going to stick to this plan, that we can't make adjustments as we go. You need to be more like taking a journey in a car, where if the road is closed, you can take an alternative route. And so you need to have that flexibility. So today, we're in business, we're adjusting between having a highly agile corporation or a corporation that has agility, because agile as a word has been somewhat polluted, and the waterfall methods where we can predict. And perhaps we have something like Eric Ries's lean startup, where we're not sure of even what the problem is, and we may need to develop a product or we may not. And so Eric Ries's book, The Lean Startup, is a great read actually for what do you do? How do you move forward? And he points out that we need to go through these very fast loops of learning, of checking, for example, what our assumptions are. We have to make assumptions about the world, but they may or may not be true. And so the planning cycle needs to be validate your assumptions and be very careful about your assumptions, because they're changing quite rapidly, especially in the technological world. And you need to have a certain amount of agility in your company, But you can't let your company become chaotic, that you need as well some stability there. So over the next few months, I'll be talking about these different approaches that we need to take, and especially in the IT area, that we shouldn't throw out totally long-term planning, that some things are not changing that rapidly, but some things are. And so the question is, what is this balance between stability and, if you like, monolithic systems and agility and these fast-moving pipelines that we're, and serverless pipelines that we're developing today in the cloud? That we need to understand what method to apply where. And so I'll be coming back over the next few weeks and months discussing these problems in more detail. Okay, bye for now.